Hello from the Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. We're so glad to have you on the line. Thanks for taking time out of your workdays to connect virtually with fellow Hoyas for today's webinar, Interview Like a Talk Show Host, Land the Job, COVID-19 edition, presented by Georgetown MBA Class of 2006 alum Jason Levin. Jason is the founder and owner of Ready, Set, Launch, LLC, and is a regular webinar presenter for us. Career and business development and outplacement coaching are his passions. Jason frequently appears on WTTG Fox 5 and has been quoted in the Wall Street Journal, Money, Fortune, and MarketWatch on business development and career-related topics. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to share just a few webinar tips and reminders. First, this webinar broadcast is being recorded, and the recording of this webinar will be made available on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours of today's broadcast. You'll receive the link to the webinar recording and a webinar follow-up email, which will also contain a post-webinar survey for you to take, information on upcoming webinars, and more ways to stay connected to the Hilltop. Jason will answer questions at the end of his webinar. Please send in your questions as you have them throughout the webinar using the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. To start off our presentation, we'll be asking for your responses to a few poll questions, so please take just a few seconds to respond to the polls. We really appreciate hearing from you guys. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties or other issues, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar system as well. Without further ado, I'm pleased to get things started and turn things over to Jason for our webinar.
Thank you, Sarah.
Sure, and I'm gonna go ahead and launch out. We've got four poll questions for you all, so I'm gonna launch those out. You'll see them go up on the screen. Please just take a couple seconds to respond to each one. And the first one we have is asking about your interview skills. So I believe my interview skills are, and then select one of the following: below average, average, above average, or you're an interviewing ninja. Leave this one open for a couple more seconds. Great, okay, so it looks like Jason, 9% of the folks said they're below average, 50% say they are average, 38% say they are above average, and 3% of you say that you're an interviewing ninja. Good for y'all.
Awesome.
Our next poll question is, when's the last time you did an informational interview? So was it less than a month ago, within the last 1 to 3 months, within the past 3 to 6 months, within the past 6 to 12 months, or you've never done an informational interview? And I'll leave this one up for just a couple seconds. If you're just now joining us, please take a minute to respond to the poll question up on the screen. Great, let's see. Jason, it looks like 33% of our attendees said they did an informational interview less than a month ago. 23% were within the last 1 to 3 months. 3% within the last 3 to 6 months. 23% within the last 12 months. And then 17% of the folks have never done an informational interview.
Okay.
Two more questions for y'all. This one is, how many years of work experience do you have? So 0 to 6, 7 to 14, 15 to 22, 23 to 30, or 30 plus years. I'll just leave this one open for a couple more seconds. Thanks for participating. Great, let's see. 22% 0 to 6 years, 25% 7 to 14 years, 28% 15 to 22 years, 22% 23 to 30 years, and 3% 30 plus years.
Wow, nice mix.
And then last poll question. What Georgetown school did you graduate from? So undergrad, MBA, law, other grad, or medical? Thanks for submitting your responses. I'll leave this open for just a couple more seconds. Great, okay. Looks like 32% are undergrad alumni, 8% are your fellow MBA alums,
nice.
18% are law alumni, 42% are other grad programs, and 0% are medical.
Probably working.
I was gonna say, that means they're probably at work, which is where we want them, that's good. All right, over to you, Jason.
Well, thank you, Sarah. Thank you so much. It is a real pleasure to be here. I appreciate what Georgetown University Alumni Career Services does to support the career development of all of our Hoyas. And I appreciate everybody being on the line. I know that we're coming together in very unique times. I hope that everybody is healthy and is safe, as well as your friends and family. I want to just talk briefly about what COVID-19 means from, I think, a career perspective now that we're all virtual. And so I have treated this webinar as if we're not getting together in person. So all of my thinking is around how you would be interacting with people from a home environment. And so whether it is that you're looking for a job or thinking about a transition or looking for a consulting project, interviewing like a talk show host will definitely be for you. So let's get into the interview chair and a little bit about more about me and why I do what I do. For me, the recession of 1990 changed everything. I was in high school growing up in northern New Jersey with my two younger brothers, and my father, who worked in the textile industry in Midtown Manhattan, lost the only job that he ever had. And so quickly, my family became aware of the uncertainty and unpleasantness that comes with unemployment. My brothers and I went on the school's free lunch program, and 6 months into my father's unemployment, we were shopping in food pantries. And so I became the wackiest teenager you ever met. I started getting subscriptions to Forbes and Fortune, and I didn't know them as informational interviews, but I was talking to all the professionals I was babysitting for. And so you could say that I've had a lifelong interest in all things career. Wherever I have worked, I've never been in an HR role. I've been in consulting roles, sales role, brand management roles, but I've always had a respect for HR business partners, for training people, recruiting people, professional development people. And so really coaching, storytelling, professional development, and recruiting have always been part of my core interests. And that's why I do what I do. So today's agenda, and I think today's agenda is going to be a thorough approach to how you think about the relationship between informational interviews and actual interviews. So I'm going to talk through some of the concerns that I normally hear when I'm working with my clients when they think about interviewing, why I think the talk show hosts of the 70s, 80s, and 90s really know interviewing, what is strategic informational interviewing, my interview prep checklist, and then the virtual formats, the phone screen, the video conference, and I think the one that's pretty challenging is the pre-recorded one-way video where you don't have anybody in front of you and you're just talking into it. And we'll talk through that also. And then how to close on every interview that is virtual. And as Sarah has said, please do use the chat box for questions. There'll be questions at the end. I'll try to get through as many as I can. So interview concerns. What do I normally hear when I'm working with folks? Well, the first is the nerves before and during an interview, which is completely normal. Coming across poised and confident in an interview. Concerns about telling a clear story, and storytelling is really key. Not feeling prepared for the interview. And this one I get from time to time. It's been 20 years since I interviewed. Where do I begin? And for me, the beginning is about asking good questions. It all begins with a good question. And so the aspiration for me is, and who I look to, the pinnacle of those that ask questions are talk show hosts. They are the ones that really know how to think about good question asking. And I think that there's an inner talk show host in each one of you on this line. And so who are some of my favorite talk show hosts? The first is Oprah Winfrey. Throughout the globe, known for her award-winning talk show that ran 25 years and arguably the most influential woman in America, a woman of many talents, Oprah has hosted over 3,800 shows where her emotional ad-lib delivery made anyone want to share their story. Larry King, over a 25-year award-winning career with CNN, Larry King has interviewed over 50,000 people, dubbed the most remarkable talk show host. King's unique conversational approach to interviewing brought talk format to primetime news. Barbara Walters. Since the 1960s, Barbara Walters entered TV and most renowned for her 20-year award-winning presence on the show 2020. Known for personality interviews and scoop interviews, Barbara knows how to talk to anyone about anything. And James Lipton, who we recently lost, may he rest in peace, host of the award-winning Inside the Actor's Studio, where for 18 years he conducted over 250 interviews with actors, directors, and writers. Audiences are mesmerized by the facts that he was able to uncover about his subjects. And so when we think about these four, you know, what are the key themes that I glean from when I think about their interviewing style? The first is they are confident and calm. The moment they get on the screen, there's a warm presence about them. They make you comfortable where you want to share your story. They're prepared and curious. They're interested in the person. And every time that I talk to hiring execs and executive search professionals, and I ask them, you know, what's the real separator when you're getting to the finalist and who eventually gets hired? And they often talk about chemistry. And the best way to create chemistry is through curiosity. They're genuine and passionate. People hire people, and I say that often, and people hire people they like. And so the more that you can be yourself, the more you can be excited about what you're talking about and what you're doing, the more you're going to be able to connect with others. And then finally, they are structured. They have a plan. They have a roadmap, a framework, an outline on how they see the interview potentially taking place. And you could see it in how they structure their questions, and you can see it on how they structure the questions off of the answers of the people that they're getting into the interview chair. So where is it that you can practice being a talk show host? Well, it's in strategic informational interviewing. You can test new ideas, you can meet new people, you can gain new perspectives. And I'm a huge fan of being strategic about your informational interviews. Some people on the line are already doing informational interviews. It is my hope that after this webinar, that you would reach out to 3 to 5 people to have a conversation. It is such a good use of your time. And so how do you reach out? For me, it's a 3-step process. Very simple, very direct. You make an ask, you get the conversation, and you do the follow-up. So how do you do these three things? So the first thing I want everybody to think about in making an ask, and I was very lucky to have some great advice when I was in high school. A family friend was an actuary. He was a financial executive for a big insurance firm. And he said to me once, Jason, if you ask for a job, you're going to get advice. If you ask for advice, you'll get a job. And that really stuck with me. And so whether you're currently in an organization where there might be an opportunity, or you're in the job hunt, or you're looking for a consulting project, being an advice seeker is the best way to approach this. And asking for advice is the best way to think about engaging others. And typically, I like to start with people you already know. And then you can move into other types of people that you find interesting. I've come up with a sample ask. And this is actually a COVID-19 specific sample ask. And it begins with really showing the uniqueness of the situation we're all in and hoping that they're okay. The first paragraph is really about how you can connect with the other person through appreciation and talk specifically about what you admire about them and what you're hoping to learn. And the second paragraph is also talking about what you're looking for. Since we're all in a remote situation right now, asking for 20 minutes of time is not a really big ask. And you're also being respectful of them that they can get back to you when they need to. And then the final sentence about valuing advice and getting back into that asking for advice piece. So, and you could do variations on this, but I think that it's really important to make an ask that is clear to them. What do you admire about them? And understanding the uniqueness of the moment. I would be using LinkedIn, Google, and for the younger folks on the line, Hoya Gateway. All great tools, all great ways to see how you have things in common with people and be able to leverage those types of things. And when you finally do get your informational interview, this is not a box to check. This is an opportunity to engage the person in front of you and come out with that inner confidence, even in practice, in your informational interview. And that's where I think of Oprah. The moment that you see her and the camera goes on her, she's up, she's appreciative, she's smiling, and everybody can bring out their inner Oprah when they're doing their informational interview. The way that you can structure your conversation, and let me tell you how I think about structuring the conversation, because it can help guide the types of questions that you ask. I like to use an inverted pyramid, taking larger ideas to smaller ideas. And the way that I think about engaging somebody is everybody's an individual, and I usually begin with that. They're probably part of a team that's part of a division, that's part of an employer, that's part of a larger industry. And if you begin with them, their experience, their vantage point, that's a great way to create that chemistry that you're looking for that I've been talking about. And so the types of questions you can be asking them are, what do you like about your work? And what's most challenging? What is your most challenging assignment right now? What trends are you noticing in this, you know, unique time? And then you can start getting more into, okay, so what are the types of people who succeed in your organization or field? What are you reading? What info sources are you using to stay current? Read what they read, and that allows for you to become more of a student of the place that you want to go. Asking for advice, even in the conversation, and asking how they approach things. And so you can find out so much great information that you normally would not find online. And actually, then it becomes a test or confirmation or denial of an initial hypothesis. Are your motivations match the interests, motivations, passions of people working in the field? How your skill set matches, how your personality matches, how success is defined by the organization, and any essential feedback to help your search. And that way, it allows for you to highlight different areas of your background, prioritize things for you. You know, I'll never forget, I was working with a marketing exec with 25 years of experience, and they were thinking, okay, do I go in-house or do I go agency? And based on conversations they were having, in-house was the clear choice for them. And so a big, big fan of the things that you can learn from in an informational interview. And then follow up, I mean, that's critical. And so get a thank you email out in less than 12 hours. Specifically, what did you learn from the conversation? Show some appreciation. Don't just do a random thank you note. Mark your tracking file. I would have a tracking file if I were you, of people you're talking to, the day you contacted them, what you learned from them. Did they promise you anything? Then I would mark your calendar as a reminder to follow up. So if they offer to make an introduction or if they offer to do something, I would mark your calendar 3 or 4 weeks after that promise just to circle back and just make sure that it actually happened. And following up, for me, there's a lot of joy in following up. but that allows to bring some structure to what you're doing. So you're moving from informational interview where you're learning all about the necessary and you finally get to this interview stage. And what is the interview preparation look like? You know, you often hear, oh, you got to do your research. Well, what kind of research? What does that look like? And when I think of research, I think of James Lipton and his blue note cards and how he used to bring out amazing facts about his subjects. And no, you don't have to get that personal with the folks that you're talking to, but bring out that inner James Lipton in doing your research about the organization and the role and the opportunities. So here's my checklist. It's about mindset, appearance, understanding the organization, understanding the interviewer, your story, and articulating the match. So when I think about mindset, the first thing I think about is getting nervous is normal. You're human. And so when I'm working with execs, when they get nervous, they either monologue and they talk way too long. With younger folks, they talk too short. And so just recognize that there are things you can be doing to calm yourself down, whether it's meditation or yoga or exercise. And for me, let me tell you the song that's going through my head whenever I get nervous. I feel pretty, oh, so pretty. And now you understand why I never went into the arts and I'm going to keep my day job. But you want to have a voice in the back of your head that is repeating the successful scenario that you're going to be successful. It's going to be a great conversation and you're going to enjoy the experience. And so you want to dress for success. And I think that recruiters and hiring managers are much more accepting now that it's harder to go to the hairdresser, harder to go to the barber. So do the best you can, but I would definitely dress as if it's an in-person interview. And that way you definitely can bring your A game. So when you're researching the organization, and whether it be private sector, public sector, nonprofit, multilateral, each of those organizations have a mission, they have a culture, they have competition, or organizations doing similar types of things. Those are things you can be finding on the website and also getting better background from the informational interviews that you're having. As you get more specific into nonprofits and private sector organizations, then the sector and industry, their business model, their customers and lines of business, recent news become more important. So do they do, are they business to business? Are they business to consumer, business to government? If they're a publicly traded organization, you could be looking at their 10K and looking at their financials. If they're a nonprofit, then you're looking at their 990 to better understand the revenue that's coming in via different fundraising activities, whether that's major gifts or corporate gifts or foundations. One thing that I do enjoy and I recommend often to my clients is go on YouTube and watch people that are working at that organization talk what it's like to be there. So take the name of the organization and pop it into YouTube. They all have YouTube channels and they all have people talking about how they are managing their career there. So I often think of YouTube as a great employer research tool. Preparing for your interviewer. So you'll probably get the name of the person that's going to be interviewing you. And so, you know, they're watching you. So go on their social media, check out their LinkedIn. What's their role in the organization? And recognize that everyone matters. There are some nuances between your initial screen from a recruiter and the hiring manager. Hiring manager is closer to the work and what actually you're going to be doing. Recruiters are often looking for fit and motivation. Never too late to informational interview if you've been talking to people in that organization to keep them updated. So that's a good use of your time. Now your story. You have the mic. And so remember that you want to get your story down as it relates to the role, to the team, to the employer. What do they care about? And so when you get a classic question like, tell me about yourself, or walk me through your resume, you want to align it with the job spec, with your informational interviews. And so tell me about yourself is a shorter answer. usually about 60, 90 seconds, where you're just giving high level things about your background and how it relates to the role. Walk me through your resume is a longer answer where you're talking about past experiences and you're talking about all this favorably. Nobody wants somebody to be talking negatively about a past work experience. If you have more than 25 years of work experience, then walk me through your resume can go to 3 to 4 minutes. You have less than 10 years of work experience. You can go chronological and it can be a 2-minute answer. The why role, why sector, why employer question, or how does this role align with your career goals? This is where you should be mentioning your informational interviews and how you feel a great fit. It can speak to your motivations and your interests. And so anytime that you can bring anecdotes in from your informational interviews, and this is a great question to do that. Strengths and weaknesses, key accomplishments. So key accomplishments, it's really important to quantify and give scope. And what I mean by scope is to bring in numbers if you can. So I was working with an attorney that was looking to become CEO of a nonprofit, and the size of the nonprofit was about 30 million. And in her past work experiences, she had run an organization that was 100 million. And never had she brought that up in any of her conversations. I was wondering why she wasn't getting callbacks. And so we made that a lot more prominent in how she talked about herself, and she was able to land it. Strengths. Remember that strengths are related to the role. So you're going into the interview. What are your strengths? You know, it's the 1, 2, 3 of the preferred and preferred qualifications of the job spec. Weaknesses are things that are there but not essential to the role. Weaknesses are more about how you receive feedback. And so when you talk about a weakness, typically it begins with, okay, I've gotten some feedback. This is how I've been working on it. And so we all have weaknesses. And so it's really more about how do you learn? How do you grow? How do you handle a difficult conversation? So that's really about half the interview. And then we get into the behavioral questions. It all begins with, tell me about a time when you, and then made a mistake and respond, delivered work under pressure. You can, you know, Google behavioral interview questions, and there's plenty of them. Really what they're looking for is specific competencies and structured stories. So there are several frameworks that you can use to hit the behavioral questions. There's STAR, which is situation, task, action, result. There's CAR, which is circumstance, action, result. PAR, problem, action, result, or SCS, situation, complication, solution. I'm a PAR fan, so I'm just going to use that as an example. So the problem. So what was the challenge you were facing when you began the role? Who were the stakeholders, internal and external? What was your thinking? What was your approach? What were your actions? Who saw your work? And what resulted from it? Now, the result could be, did you write a report? Did you do analysis and present to the chief marketing officer? Did you influence the board? Did you reduce costs? Did you increase revenue? I think that there are plenty of results that you can talk about. And really it's for you to think through what are the types of stakeholders that you were working with to make that happen. I was working with a government contracting exec where he was not talking about the fact that in a merger situation, he was presenting to the board on a $500 million acquisition and was played a major role in making that happen. And so he and I were talking about how to better articulate that because he kept on saying, well, we did this and we did that. I call that the I-we conundrum because yes, you don't do things individually, you do things in teams. And you can talk about the team and you can talk about the stakeholders, but then you need to talk about your role in working with that team. And so we got the story down and it worked out a lot better. And he ended up getting a very nice role. I'm a big fan of timing your stories. And so most responses to behavioral questions can be around 120 seconds. And using an online stopwatch or using a stopwatch on your phone helps you get to the point. I was working with a finance exec who had 25 years of experience, and he said, okay, Jason, Let me tell you how I start my interviews. I give a 10-minute talk on everything that I know, and that way they know everything that I've done. And I said, well, that's the reason you're not moving on in your interviews is because you're monologuing. And so we had him break it up into specific stories and started timing his answers. And his next interview said, oh my gosh, it worked. I was like, yeah, because nobody's listening to a 10-minute monologue. So you're timing your stories, and then it's, okay, so how do I prioritize what stories I need to talk about? I'm a big fan of using a 4x4, and this is what I mean. So on the left-hand side, there's story one, there's story two, story three, story four. It's essentially the three or four things that you're most proud of in your career that you want to talk about that you've loaded into PAR format. The upper part where I'm talking about change and passion and expertise and team and people, you can go into the job spec and look at the qualifications and the preferred qualifications and say to yourself, okay, here are the four reasons why they're going to hire me, and write them down. So you think, all right, they're going to hire me for this, this, and this. And then what you can do is align your PAR stories with the competencies that you think you're going to get hired on. And for example, story one might hit on two of the competencies depending on how they ask the question. Leading teams or risk management or litigation or growing startups or whatever that looks like. And if you do a 4x4, you will go in with a much more structured approach because then you have already gamed out what you think they're going to ask and you've already worked through those specific types of stories. And then when they get to, do you have questions for me? And the answer is, well, you bet. And you've been doing that, of course, in your informational interviews and using your inverted pyramid. And so there are plenty of things that you can be asking. You know, what's the challenge you're facing? Tell me more about the role. What are the two or three essential elements to succeed in the role? How does this role support your work, your boss's work? How do you like to lead and manage? One big question party. And this is a great way to get back to being that inner talk show host, creating that chemistry, and asking things about them. Because I talk to hiring execs again and again and ask them, all right, top three reasons why you hired somebody. Often they will say, well, they ask great questions. And so here are some great questions. And curiosity just creates that chemistry. And so when you are in the interview, I want you to be passionate like Larry. He brought an incredible amount of energy to his work. And so I want you to bring that same level of energy to your virtual interview formats. Okay. And so I understand it's harder to do that virtually, but don't forget that people want to engage you. People want to know you. And so the two key interview formats will be phone and video. And then the permutation on the video conference is the pre-recorded interview. So let's start with some phone screen pointers. Be in a quiet space where you get all the bars on your phone. You want to have printouts of your resume, prepared questions, key organization information, and other research in front of you. Phone screens are actually fun because you can just have everything right in front of you. You don't want to read verbatim, but you can have everything as a reminder and get your talking points down. Smile so that your voice comes through. There's a lot of research on smiling. Sometimes I even have my clients look in a mirror or look at a funny video before they go into the interviews just so that they're up and they're relaxed and they're smiling. Be curious about your interviewer as well as the role. Get the interviewer talking in the beginning. How are they? How are they handling things? A little compassion, a little curiosity will definitely go far, especially during this time. Answer the question that was asked, not the question you rehearsed, not the question you wish they asked. Answer the question that was actually asked. And I get this often from execs where they either monologue or they come in with a rehearsed answer. Make sure you understand what they are asking you and respond accordingly. You might have prepared something, adjust it to the question they are asking. Keep your responses short to get feedback from your interviewer. They might have some silence. It's okay. They're probably taking notes. So when you give your answer, just stop. Perfect. So Moving from phone screen to video conference. Do a technology and sound check with a friend or family member. Be careful about background noises, such as clicking pens. I'm gonna click my pen, hear that? That's annoying. And I had a recruiter tell me that there was somebody interviewing, they couldn't stop clicking their pen and they stopped listening to them. Moving things like playing with paper. So keep things so that the sound is clear. Keep yourself in view. The camera should be around eye level, which means you might need to prop up your computer with some books or a shoebox. Head and shoulders is ideal. So it depends on where the camera is coming from. For some, it's at the top of the computer. For some, it's closer to the keyboard. So make sure that you're working with that so that you're getting your head and shoulders in the right view. And for lighting, use a simple desk lamp near your computer if you have one. Creates a better overall look and feel. Keep the dial-in numbers available as a backup in case the computer audio does not work. In that case, you would mute your computer audio. Remember the key points that you want to get across, and you can use sticky notes around your computer to help jog your memory. I would find a quiet spot and ensure that you're the only one on screen. Shut off all other technology so as not to disturb the conversation. Right now, I have my entire family in the basement, so they can't, so they're not going to come in. So manage expectations with family, roommates, and pets. Well, I mean, pets are hard, and certain family members that are under the age of 3 are also hard. And I think people are understanding. But at the very least, let everybody know that you're hoping for quiet. I would dress as if it's an in-person interview, and again, smile and be positive, answer the question asked, and be curious about your interviewer. And finally, the pre-recorded or the one-way video pointers, and I think this is really important. All the video conference tips apply. Make sure your story is clear and concise. There will be time limits on your answer, so it might be a minute or it might be 2 minutes. And so that's why you want to make sure that you're conversational and you're not just writing out and reading your responses. You're coming in with real stories, and this is where you take out your stopwatch. So you might not get a phone screen. You might just get a link where you have to talk into something and answer 5 to 10 questions. And so your stopwatch will be a great friend in helping you get to the point. And it might seem awkward talking into a computer or a phone, which I'm doing right now, but you can show your personality. You don't have to drone on, but you can use voice inflection and try to connect with the video itself so that you can move beyond this pre-recorded video to an actual human being. Close like Barbara. Love the way Barbara used to close on 2020. We're in touch, so you be in touch. And the way you close, you want to close on a high note, show interest and excitement for the role, the team, and the employer. Handle any ejections. I mean, something you can be asking towards the end of the interview is, this sounds like it really is a great fit. Do you have any reservations about my candidacy? And that allows for any type of other conversation where they hope that you might talk about something. You know, something to think about, something that you might want to bring up. Ask about next steps in the process. And again, make sure that you get an email thank you note out in 12 hours. So, interview recap thoughts. Be yourself and enjoy the process. Informational interviewing is a great way to connect. And especially now in a remote environment, it's a great way to just be with people right now since we're all home. Informational interviewing is key to successful interviewing. Use your knowledge from your informational interviews to guide your story. You are the only one to tell it. Reflect positively on your career. Whether it's 5 years of experience or 25 years of experience, you've done interesting things. And keep working on telling that story. Use a 4x4 to rehearse responses to classic behavioral interview questions. It's a good use of your time. Embrace virtual technology formats. Practice, prepare, and repeat. And bring out your inner talk shows. Don't forget to ask questions. Questions are wonderful. Questions are great. Nothing but questions. So feel free to keep in touch. Here's my email. Feel free to keep me in mind either as an outplacement and career retirement transition solution in your organization, a BD coach in your professional services firm like accounting, law, or consulting, potential speaker, webinar presenter, your own challenges. Here's my website, Twitter, Facebook. Best of luck. My next webinars will be in April. I'll be doing one on business development for lawyers. And at the end of the month, what you can be doing with potential layoffs. For those that are in the DC area, I'm actually going on TV on Saturday talking about how to do a video conference interview, not that different than what we just talked about here. And now I will be more than happy to take some questions.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Jason. You just covered a ton of content. So that was excellent and super helpful to everyone. Thanks so much. A couple of just quick responses to questions I've been getting. This webinar session has been recorded, and so you'll receive the link to the webinar recording in the webinar follow-up email, so you'll be able to watch this later on. And I will include Jason's contact information so that you all can follow up, continue the conversation with Jason, ask additional questions and everything to continue today's conversation. So be on the lookout for that. Jason, diving into questions, and y'all please feel free to submit your questions through the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. Diving into questions, first off, do you have any tips for communicating with extremely rigid or formal or cold interviewers? Is it better to match their energy or to try and be outgoing and personable?
So I would be yourself. I would be yourself. And so certain people just come across as rigid. And that's just a first glance. I would not, I am a big fan of mimicking energy in general, but if somebody's rigid, I would not become rigid just because they're rigid. Just be yourself and it'll work out fine. And that, those are hard interviews because you're not getting any feedback from them on whether you've landed the answer correctly or not. So I understand the question, but just be yourself.
Awesome, thank you. Another question, most Fortune 500 companies don't agree to informational interviews because of liability concerns. They'll only interview for posted positions. Any tips or tricks for how to kind of break through the world there to be able to talk with folks at those companies if they're only doing interviews for posted positions?
So if you're getting, okay, we're not going to be, you know, interviewing, or we're not going to be doing informational interviewing for a particular organization, I would see if you could find a recruiter that works with that organization to get a better understanding on how they do things. An external recruiter, not an internal one. That's one way to approach it.
Awesome. This next question, best way to cold call or email industry experts and fellow alumni that you don't know to ask for informational networking interviews. I'm going to let Jason answer this one as well, but I want to just jump in here and put in a plug for Hoya Gateway. It's a fantastic resource for this, especially for alumni and industry experts. Hoya Gateway, if you all don't know about it, it is Georgetown's premier. It was originally designed for student and alumni networking. It is now fully supporting alumni to alumni networking. It is a community of more than 10,000 Hoyas who are available, open, and willing and excited to connect with you and fellow Hoyas for career conversations, networking, and informational interviews. And that's what it's really designed for. I will send out the link to Hoya Gateway. Sign up is super easy. You can import your LinkedIn profile, so all that information will be uploaded for you. There's a way to do it, and it just walks you through that whole process. So it's super easy to set up a profile. And they are actually a Georgetown-founded company, founded by a 2012 alum, Riley Davis, People Grove company. And they're rolling out all kinds of new tools within this current climate to help you better connect with folks on there. So, you know, Zoom capabilities and things like that are coming online. So anyway, if you're looking to connect with specifically Georgetown alumni who have already raised their hands and are saying, I'm here to help fellow Hoyas, Hoya Gateway is a fantastic, fantastic resource to do it. So I really highly recommend it. Jason, is there anything else you want to plug in terms of this question?
Yeah, so I completely agree. And I've just moved my slide to show Hoya Gateway and the icon for it. I just want to show again the sample ask and different things that you could be asking. In addition to Hoya Gateway, there's probably local professional associations that are doing webinars or people that you could connect with in the city that you're in. That's a really great way to think about things. Professional associations, trade associations, and a lot of this can be done locally and virtually. And here's a sample ask of a way to think about how to approach somebody so that if you're reaching out to somebody cold, that they might respond. And I agree with you. I think the level 101, the easiest way to do it is to get an introduction. If you don't have an introduction, Hoya Gateway or something local via an association.
Absolutely. Another question, how should you respond to the question about salary expectations during an informational interview?
So, you know, it never gets old. You know, there's two schools of thought, you know, that you let them answer or you come up with an answer. You know, I think that you can ask them what the position, what the budget for the position is. You could also come up with an amount that you were making in your last role and see what the budget range is. But I mean, really, at the end of the day, you want to get to what is the range that they have. I would first start with that question and see where they go from there.
Great, thank you. Another one for you. I recently had a video interview for my dream job. I didn't think it went well, but I recently got a second interview. Congratulations, that's great. And I'm so nervous. What are some tips for a second video interview with the same person?
Awesome. So I think the first thing that you need to do is in your head, one, recap the things that you enjoyed about them and what they said. So you want to go in and say, all right, our last conversation was a confirmation that this role, the team working with you would be incredible. The second piece is, all right, saying to yourself, all right, what were the talking points or what didn't you get across that you want to get across? And so I would rehearse that. I would work on that. And then the third piece is I would go in with a good close and let them know why you would be the perfect fit for this. So that's how I would think about it. And congrats on getting the second round.
Yeah, congratulations. And don't get in your own head. They interview tons of people. You know, it's one of those things where you probably have been going over it and over it in your mind, and where they've gone on and talked to a ton of different people. So, you know, I know it feels really big for you, but just be confident in yourself and you'll do great. Another question for you, Jason. Do you have any advice for a PhD looking to work in business or nonprofit on how to use the interview to sell transferable skills and knowledge over the years of traditional work experience? Spending time in school versus getting traditional work experience, and kind of walk us through the dynamic there.
Sure. And congratulations on your PhD. I mean, that's that in and of itself is a testament to your dedication and your ability to focus. And actually, that would be one of the first things I'd be talking about. You know, I once did a talk for a group of PhDs, and it was called Lost in Translation: How to Take Your Academic CV and Turn It into a Professional Resume. And so in working with PhDs, the issue is that there's so much knowledge that it's so hard for you to get to the actual point. And so as you're doing informational interviews, I think the things that you can be gleaning is, okay, so these professional environments, whether it be nonprofit or multilateral or corporate, how have I done similar types of things? How have I collaborated? How have I used technology? How have I taught? And so your informational interviews can probably be teaching you 3 to 5 things that are probably transferable. And one of the questions that I would be asking the folks that you're talking to is, like, what areas of my background do you find most interesting? And then be able to hone in on that as you talk about yourself. So kudos to you for having a PhD, and go get them.
Awesome. Another question, when given an undesirable salary amount or range that is not your preferred amount during an informational interview, how do you give a neutral enough response to leave room for negotiations at an official offer?
Okay, well, you can say, well, listen, it's a It's a little low on the range, but I don't think that we should stop the conversation right now. Let's keep talking. Let's put that on the side. And I want to make sure that there's a right fit for both of us, and then we can come back to it.
That's great. Thank you. What's the most productive way to spend time waiting for your interview results? So let's say you've gone a week or 2 weeks and you haven't heard anything and you're wondering how to best demonstrate interest without pestering. The classic, should I follow up or not follow up questions?
All right. So the first thing you need to do is you need to go on YouTube and you need to find Tom Petty. And Tom Petty wrote a wonderful song called The Waiting is the Hardest Part. and I think he wrote that for job seekers. And so Tom Petty and Eddie Vedder did a wonderful live version of The Waiting. And so I love the question because waiting is part of this process. And so I would say to you, first understand the next steps in the process. Okay, we're going to get back to you from a week, in a week from now. And a week from now goes by and nothing happens. I would wait a few days after that. If you still don't hear anything, then I would circle back in like 2 or 3 weeks. They know that you're interested. There might be things that are going on. And now that we're in a virtual environment, I think that there's going to be a lot more waiting going on.
Great, thank you. And then you addressed this with a pre-recorded interview, but how do you suggest following up after one of those? And this question even says, how do you follow up after a robotic interview? I wonder, is that, do you think, going to be the way of the future?
You know, it depends on the industry. It depends on the organization. You know, what pre-recorded interviews are really are about is to help get a feel for a person where there's multiple stakeholders that are involved in disparate areas. So I think that pre-recorded interviews are definitely a tool that are being used. I think their increase will happen now that we're in a remote environment now. I would, after you do the pre-recorded interview, whoever you're interacting with, I would do a very nice follow-up note with them and then see what happens. And then, you know, again, wait 2 or 3 weeks and follow up again.
Great. Thank you so much. And then one of our final questions, how do we properly prepare for a phone screen? Should we act as if it's a real interview? What do those typically entail?
So I agree that phone screens should be exactly as if you are in a real interview environment. I'm just bringing my tips back up on phone screens. So I think for me, the phone screen is really important to them because they need to be able to just get a sense of who you are. And actually, for me, I think phone screens are a little bit easier than video because it gives you time to think. It gives you time to process, assuming you have your notes in front of you. But I would definitely treat a phone screen like a real interview. Some people say they need to get dressed up and professional to do an effective phone screen. For me, I don't think you become any more intelligent just because you're in sweatpants, but do what's right for you and find an environment that you're comfortable in that you can actually get the necessary across for that phone screen.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jason. Any final words or pieces of advice to leave us with before we close out?
I just want to say thank you to everybody. I want to wish everybody good health. I want to wish everybody safe, be safe. I want to wish everybody good Wi-Fi throughout all of this, most importantly. Appreciate coming together and let's look to find ways to support each other throughout this. And we'll get through this. We'll all get through this and then we get to go back outside again. So thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Jason. Thanks to all of you for joining us today. Wishing you a wonderful rest of your week. Hoya Saxa.